Welcome to Incognito, the podcast, where I converse with interesting guests from a variety of fields and disciplines about how they foster inclusive workplaces and communities. Over the years, my conversation with today's guest have always been loads of fun and deeply spiritual. Toni, as I recently discovered in today's conversation, is the embodiment of a kindness cheerleader. She shows up with laughter and empathy, which translate easily into a sense of connection with whomever is in the room. There are so many things to pull out of our conversation, from her love for the arts to her ability to grow arugula better than anybody as one of her core identities. I hope you'll find this conversation as fun, insightful, and revelatory as I did. Welcome to Incognito, the podcast. I'm your host, Michael Fosberg, and my guest today is Toni Wynn. In the culture workspace, Toni develops exhibits, collaborates on visitor-centered experiences in public venues, and supports anti-oppression initiatives. As an educator, she specializes in STEAM, that's STEM with an A, meaning the arts, community building, and arts education. Toni designs and facilitates transdisciplinary workshops, recently at the Mapping Meaning Retreat at Ghost Ranch, the Arts and Society Conference in Paris, and at Museum as Site for Social Action, Mass Action at the Minneapolis Institute of Art. A Cave Canem graduate fellow and member of the community of writers, Toni Wynn has shared the mic with some of her favorite writers. Toni's poetry, essays, articles, and creative nonfiction appear in publications such as Black Nature and the International Review of African American Art. She collaborates on limited edition broadsides and handmade books available at ToniWynn.com. She has served as an advisor to the California Arts Commission and the Virginia Commission for the Arts. She studied international relations, social welfare, and instructional technology at Clark University, the University of Copenhagen, San Francisco State University, and Virginia Tech. What we reach for and invent to sustain ourselves and protect others pulls Toni's work. Toni Wynn, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you for welcoming me to the podcast. I feel welcome, Michael.
This is terrific. Full disclosure, we've known each other for many years, and it's just a delight to have you here and to speak with you. And I want to start right off the bat by talking about the last sentence of your bio. And if you could, I want to read it again. And if you could share for listeners what that is, what that means to you. What we reach for and invent to sustain ourselves and protect others pulls Toni's work.
I'm really interested, Michael, in the way that humans intersect and interact. And at bottom, we're kind. And it doesn't usually take too much to evince or uncover that kindness. So that's what I'm sensitive to. And getting to that place with a group of people, with just a couple of people in the room, it doesn't really matter. But it's genuine, it's inspiring, it's inspired, it's unfiltered. And that's where I want to live professionally and personally and as a caring member of the community.
That's so beautiful. I mean, as listeners will note, I read people's bios at the beginning of the show to introduce people, obviously, and we talk a little bit about how bios are really about accomplishments and stuff, but I've yet to have someone add such a distinctly beautiful statement at the end of their bio. And usually what I ask is, and I think you've sort of given this beautiful explanation of it, but I want to know more about how you see yourself in the world. Like what kind of things are core? I mean, and you just gave us such a beautiful description of that, but what kinds of things are core to your identity?
There are too many things because I'm old.
No, don't start there.
I had a couple of grandmothers. There was one that I didn't have. She died before I was born, my paternal grandmother. But my mom had two moms. She had the mom who birthed her and with whom she had a relationship, you know, through life, but also the woman who raised her. And that woman always spoke, even when she was literally 104 years old and had dementia, she would always talk about being kind. And that's my North Star.
Yeah.
So all of the other thing, I mean, and it's hard, right? Sometimes it's hard. Sometimes I can be unkind, but I try to like throw those drafts away. You know, when you write an email, it's just like, nope, I'm not going to send it. I'm just going to leave that right here and I'm going to go have a nice pot of tea.
Yeah.
You know, and then you delete it. So it's those kinds of moments, you know, that it's just like, I can actually go there, no question, but I don't have to transmit it. So there are so many different ways that I do see myself. I mean, you know, just descriptors. I'm a swimmer. I'm a person who grows better arugula than anybody else. I love windows. I, you know, love children. I love shadows. I used to be a cheerleader. And, you know, people give cheerleaders a really hard time for good reason. But let me just say this.
Okay.
Here we all are, right? Like old cheerleaders never die. You know, we are hopeful individuals for the most part.
Uh-huh.
You know, I, for one, am of the generation where in high school, lots of people were high. And so our teams like didn't win because they were high, right? So, you know, so like you're out there and you're cheering, but nothing is gonna happen. So, you know, it's a different zeitgeist. It's a different.
Yeah. Sure, sure.
But that, you know, I mean, here I am, you know, decades and decades older, but that spirit is still very much a part of me. It was, you know, it was athletic, it was futile. You know, it was fun. And, you know, here we are.
Yeah.
And maybe it has something to do with being kind. And maybe it has something to do with arugula. I don't know. But it's all, you know, it's all just kind of mixed up in here.
And how much of your being a Black woman affects the other qualities that you find to be core to your existence?
Much, if not all, probably not all, because, I mean, I don't have a choice, right? I'm a Black woman. I am quite fortunate to be a Black woman. I am grateful every day for that. Mm. And especially being an old Black woman, like, excuse me, can you think of anything better than that? Like, I mean, it's just like all the wit, you know, the wisdom, the mother wit, the respect, the memes, the fuzzy white hair, you know, the soft skin. Oh my gosh. Such a privilege.
Tell it.
So, so that informs so much of how I move through the world, but there's a whole part of me that it's so fundamental that I almost don't feel like I need to address it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So I find when I'm, you know, when I'm writing poetry, that rarely do I write about race.
Mm.
And I could be writing about something else and it will come through, right? You know, I don't have to,
you
know, cognitively just go, I'm going to write this thing about, you know, about this racial incident or whatever, because I could be writing about peonies and something, you know, will just come right on through that just hooks it right in. I don't have to think about it.
Yeah.
So that's beautiful. So it's like unyoking myself from that, you know, Sturm und Drang of, you know, oh, you know, this is a burden, or this is hard. It's not necessarily hard. It's the way it is. I mean, certainly I would appreciate it being easier to be a Black woman in this society. No question.
Yeah.
I'm ready for any of that.
Yes.
But given the way it is,
yeah. I'm good. Well, so then let's talk about, have you ever felt walking into a room that your identity was or might be an obstacle? And it doesn't necessarily have to be about being a Black woman. It could be something else, but as long as we are on that topic.
Sure. Less walking into a room, because Michael, I have to say that one of the things I love is walking into a room full of wealthy, I am not wealthy, especially white people, and asking them for money. I used to be on a board of an arts organization, and my hands shot up when they said, you know, who wants to, you know, do development and do the ask? I want to do the ask. I want to be that person who says, get off your trip, you know, and write that check.
Well, because you're the cheerleader.
Is that why?
You're the cheerleader.
Okay.
That's absolutely.
It all makes sense.
Yeah.
But the spaces that, to me, are less comfortable are really the outdoor spaces, because that's when I find, if I'm in Montana or Idaho or, you know, XYZ space.
Yeah.
And it's the great outdoors. And I just feel othered. I feel just like, wait a minute, there aren't a lot of other people who look like me here.
Mm-hmm.
And perhaps, probably, I'm not expected to be here.
Mm.
And because I'm not expected to be here, then perhaps the welcome mat is not necessarily rolled out.
Mm, yeah.
So that for me is where the discomfort is more prevalent in my life. And I do love being outdoors.
Yeah.
I had an experience just this summer. For the first time, I was in Martha's Vineyard.
Yeah.
And I couldn't believe it. It was the first time in my fairly long life that I had been outdoors in the United States of America and felt as safe. It was remarkable.
As safe as you did there?
Yes.
Were you on the Inkwell?
You know, I don't think so. My family had rented a house, and we were in and out of Oak Bluffs, which is, you know, kind of the nucleus of the Black community there. But it was all so cool.
Yeah, yeah. We should tell our listeners who don't know that Oak Bluffs was, as you mentioned, the sort of the center of the Black community there. And the Inkwell is very close to Oak Bluffs. And that was traditionally a Black beach.
Black beach, right. Yeah.
African-American.
But it was phenomenal. I mean, I'm used to, you know, being maybe in the Caribbean, XYZ, right? And, you know, in Black spaces, Black outdoor spaces, that just feel great and comfortable. But this was a revelation to me.
Oh, wow.
So I would love to feel that way.
In other places.
In
Montana and Idaho and national parks in the West and Southwest. Yes, yes. So let's talk a little bit about your work then. In your work, how do you go about creating an environment conducive to collaboration?
Mostly by just showing up as my fairly wacky self. I do what I can to establish a baseline of realness.
Mm.
And care, such that I want to know the kind of day you're having. Let's not just get to the agenda. Or part of the agenda actually is the check-in. Who are you feeling like you are today? And, you know, how can we care for you?
Mm.
Maybe without saying those words. I mean, during the pandemic, it was so easy to say those words.
Yes.
And that was one of the things that I really treasure about that time and want to and intend to funnel into this period, this kind of shoulder period, right, where we're, you know, a little bit in and, you know, and mostly out, but trying to figure it out, of just like, hey, I really care about who you are and about the dog that's on your sofa and, you know, and anybody else who might be running in and out. So let's do that before we get to the business of the business. And if that has to stop in the middle for some other reason, then we'll do that too. But that's important to me is to for me to show up with laughter, with empathy, with a sense of connection to who is in the room, and whether that room is electronic or, you know, where they're breathing each other's air, masked or not. It's my job as a collaborator, as a coworker, to try to establish that space.
And I'm assuming that is, as you said, it's so important to you, that is really something that you start off with before you really get down to the work that you're tasked to collaborate on or whatever. Yes.
Yes. Yeah. That feels right to me. And there, of course, are people who can be impatient with that. Whatever reason, however they're showing
up. Sure, sure.
And so it's not to just go on and on and on with the anecdotes and this and that, but just enough so that there's a little bit of, you know, okay, you know, it's, this is an okay space to relax. And, you know, as an actor, you know, as a person who plugs into so many communities in so many different ways, the way you do, that bringing warmth to a space goes a long way.
Absolutely. Well, so that brings me a perfect segue to the next question. So what do you do with when you're confronted in a situation like that, where you sense that there's someone or something in the room that is, I don't know, hesitant to open themselves up or to be open to the process that you're presenting? How do you go about overcoming that? What methods do you use to do?
Well, I have to breathe. I've been practicing yoga for over 30 years. And, you know, and I will do my breathing and my reassessment and kind of check in with myself to see, hey, have I overstepped? You know, and if so, let me pull back, regroup. You know, how's everybody else in the room? If it's just the two of us, then we could just check in. It's just like, hey, you know, how can we realign so that, you know, so that we can, because usually there's something amiss somehow. If there's an opportunity during a break, you know, for me to go up and just say, I noticed you're a little bit hesitant, or, you know, is there something that we can work through together? Is everything good?
Yeah.
Just so that there's a personal, you know, some kind of personal check-in, as opposed to poof, whatever. You know, that said, I was in a situation quite a number of years ago now where I was asked to midwife the birth of an organization that is concerned with race in the museum space. And I was working with a co-facilitator. We were asked to facilitate their first retreat.
Oh, wow.
And it was a difficult birth. I'm happy to say that over the years, the organization has done good work.
Yeah.
So they, you know, they kept it moving and all that, but it was, there were, I don't know how many of us in this space, maybe somewhere between 15 and 20 people in the room. And it was, you know, winter in the Midwest and, you know, we're in a basement and there we all are dealing with how to structure an organization that needed to be able to breathe and grapple with so many different things, and all the personal stuff, and the fact that so many folks came in defensive, and so many folks also came in having not done their own bias work, just thinking, hey, we are progressive humans and we know what's best and what our intent is.
Yeah.
And we're just going to get out there and do this work without having done it themselves. So there was a moment where there was a confrontation. Folks got called out, cussed out, all the things. And the organizers, their default was to grab power back from the facilitators. And then there were a few, there were a couple of interns and some younger folks coming into the space, and they literally hid behind a chalkboard.
Oh my gosh.
Literally, I found them back there.
Oh my God.
Okay. So I mean, it was flying. It was.
Yeah.
So my co-facilitator and I took some time together and decided, let's just let this play out.
Yeah.
Because anything that we insert right here somehow is going to be the wrong thing for somebody, and it's just going to send them ricocheting across the walls. So, you know, we spent the next couple of very tense hours just exhausting each other.
Yeah.
What happened? But then, you know, after a meal, and, you know, and we came back together that evening, and folks started to apologize, and we ended up getting the work done, and life went on. But, you know, to answer your question, how did you came into the space one way, and everything just went kaflooey. It could have been, it was awful.
Yeah.
But then, you know, we went back to our intention of why are we here? What's the work? This is how hard it is. It's going to be this hard or harder for the folks that we want to do it with out in the world.
Yeah.
So we best be able to handle it ourselves right here. Right? Right.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to say that this is, I talk about this tool. I have these tools that I use for my work. And one of the tools is get comfortable being uncomfortable.
Yes.
And it's funny because I tell people quite often, I've found myself in situations in these, having conversations and guiding, facilitating dialogues and whatnot, where I'll be in just a very, very uncomfortable moment. And I'm just, my whole insides are just squirming. Yes, exactly. They're squirming. They're just like, oh my gosh, this is excruciating. But I know from experience that if I just sit with it and just go through it, not try to avoid it, not try to make it better, that it will get better, but you have to go through it. And your example is a good example of, it may be longer than a minute or 10.
Yes.
Or 20.
Yeah.
It may take more time. And for many people, like, that is just not going to happen. Like, they're going to book.
They're out of there. Yeah.
They're out of there. Right. And so you can be rewarded if you stay. You will be rewarded if you stay. Mm-hmm. And if you stick with it. But most people would probably feel like, I can't do that. And so it's a tribute to you and your co-facilitator that you stuck through it, and that they stuck through it, and that you were all able to come out the other end. Because that's a really, really uncomfortable place to be, but that's a place where we need to be.
You know, it's where the tough stuff gets done.
Yeah.
It doesn't all have to be that tough, but sometimes it is. I mean, this is life, right? I mean,
right.
If you take it out of that kind of facilitated space, as adults, we all just get hit with terrible stuff.
Right.
And we get through it, right? So this
right.
is no
that's
different.
Right. That's right.
We can yes. cut and run. Absolutely.
Yes. Yes.
But then it's unresolved, right? Yes. And, you know, and you're running from your diagnosis, or you're running from yes. the relationship, or whatever it is. But if you stick with it, then there is going to be an outcome, and it may not be exactly what you wanted, but maybe what you wanted wasn't quite right for it anyway.
Right, right, right. Yeah, well, I say, like, just saying the line, get comfortable being uncomfortable, who would want to do that? Like, that sounds like a stupid thing. Like, when I say it, people look at me like, that's stupid. I don't want to get comfortable being uncomfortable. But the fact is, like you just pointed out, that everybody gets uncomfortable through the course of a day. Any day of your life, there's a moment you're uncomfortable with, and you work through it somehow. And sometimes those moments are a lot longer. They last days or months at a time, but you continue to work through it. So I think that's a terrific example of how to go about getting through it. So in your workplace or the projects that you tackle, how do you go about forging new connections with people and in and outside of that community? And are there any particular methods or techniques or approaches that you use to, and I think you've actually mentioned one of them at the top, you talked about asking people about how they are and who they are and where they are in the moment. But are there other things that you do to bring people together to make those connections in a room?
You know, I do tend to ask a lot of questions, and yeah. I try not to ask the basic American questions, you know, what do you do? And
yeah, right.
You know, that kind of thing, right? But, you know, to find out what, you know, what people care about. That's one of the reasons that I love working with middle school kids, because they are right there on the cusp of figuring out what they care about. And, so you know, true. And you get through a bunch of silly stuff, and I love the silly stuff. And then it's just like, well, wait a minute. It's just, can you tell me more about such and such? So this is where the arts in STEAM really
yes.
steps forward, because, you know, if you're with a bunch of engineers, I don't know. I mean, you know, there are all kinds of different, there's like all kinds of engineering, right? There, I mean, the kind that, you know, that keeps bridges, that, you know, standing, and the kind that's all math based and all this other stuff. But somehow or other, if we can unite over a poem or a piece of music or something that, you know, that's a soul connection, that is going to me, that's going to be the through line. That's going to endure. And that's going to give us a metaphor or a thread that we can weave together throughout whatever it is that we're about to do.
Yeah.
If we're lucky.
Yeah.
And to me, the arts is part of our luck as humans, because, you know, other animals don't get the arts. We do. Yeah. You know, it's one of the few things about being a human being that I appreciate every day, because otherwise it's like, really? We could go on. But anyway, that's, you know, I'm scattershot on this, Michael.
Yeah.
But truly, you know, I like to have a soul connection with folks that's not forced. I mean, everybody does an icebreaker, that kind of thing. And I love it when it's maybe tactile, or maybe we're singing, or, you know, something that's off the beaten track like that.
That's wonderful. That's great. So, I mean, now I'm going to sort of duplicate this, and you've given such a beautiful description of that. But if there was one thing that you could recommend to listeners that could act as a catalyst for a more inclusive society or a workplace, what would that be?
I've got to go back to kindness.
Kindness.
Being kind to yourself is unbelievable. To start with caring for yourself the way you would care for someone who is dear to you.
Yeah.
Wow. I don't know that many of us are taught that in this society.
Yeah.
My father always used to say, gotta take care of number one, Toni Wynn. He always used to say that. Gotta take care of number one. If it's for me, it's the best, he would always say. So that has translated through my life, and seeing that, you know, almost, you know, that yogic, the light in me, you know, recognizes the light in you, that's always, always an option to see that light in someone else, to see that, wait a minute, you are doing this particular thing that I'm having a really hard time with right now, but maybe you are an amazing bassoonist. Maybe you know, your ceramics are incredible. Maybe you know how to weave, and I've always wanted to learn how to weave. Maybe you make unbelievable hot toddies. So, you know, so somehow or other, I mean, everybody's got some terrific, cool thing that they are, you know, and I just hope and pray that before the end of our lives, we've discovered those things, because that's also a gift, to have the wherewithal, to have the time and space in the world to discover what we bring to the world that is just uniquely fabulous.
And delicious.
And delicious!
Yes, yes. I sort of describe it, Joseph Campbell used to talk about find your bliss or follow your bliss. And bliss doesn't necessarily have to be a career path. It could just be something that, as you described, something that you just really, really like to do, or you're really good at, or that you really contribute, or that you just are jazzed about, or whatever it might be. So that's a beautiful way to put it. So with all of that, and I know this is actually, I know you've already defined this for me in my mind, but for listeners, we all define words, particular words, differently. And we all, of course, have our own biases that we come to the table with. But if I'm going to ask you what it means to be authentic, how would you describe that? And what does that look like for you?
Being authentic means self-acceptance. It means accepting who you are in the moment, who you've been, and understanding that that is valid, that however you show up is absolutely valid and does not require questioning. You know, when working with kids in the art space, I would hear so often, I don't know, we're going to this place, we're going to a reading, or, you know, we're going to a gallery or whatever, and I don't understand such and such, you know. And I would just say, however you show up is perfect. You don't have to do anything other than be who you are, looking at this particular piece of art or listening to this song.
Yeah.
You are perfect in that moment. And whatever you get from it, you get. And if you choose to dig deeper, try it yourself, mess around with it, outstanding. And if you don't, that's cool too. Being authentic for me is definitely about self-acceptance and knowing that you are completely fine showing up.
Right. Yeah, yeah. No, that's absolutely right. I was thinking about what you said earlier about how did you put it? Something about showing up as your crazy self. Is that's the first when you walk into the door, when you walk into a room and you're about to engage people and you just want to be your crazy self. And I just love that, because you are in acceptance of your joy, of your cheerleaderness, of your kindness, and you walk into the room and you go, okay, here it is. and
it's on.
Yeah, right. I can't think of anything more authentic than that. That's just beautiful. Toni, this has been really great. I can't thank you enough. It's such a joy to talk to you. I want to ask one last question. Can you recommend a book, a movie, a play, of any kind of art thing which has inspired you recently, and why?
Okay, this is a whole other podcast episode. I was so lucky that I got to work really closely with the August Wilson House in Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
The house where he grew up till age 13. And part of that work was reading his century cycle, his 10, yes. his 10 plays.
Yes.
Okay. That's the kind of work I get to do, right? Not shabby. So, you know, let me just put that out there, that August Wilson is a genius. And, you know, I have a couple of favorite plays of his, but Joe Turner's Come and Gone to me is one of the most remarkable on so many levels. Almost somehow I couple that with Donald Glover's Atlanta, that TV show.
Sure.
Yeah, just that incredible darkness that's got magic going on in it.
Yeah.
So anyway, that. And
yes.
So many books. So right now, the books that I'm fascinated with all have Black in the title. Black on Earth is one of them. African-American Eco-Literary Traditions by Kimberly Ruffin.
Okay.
And again, you know, going back to what we were talking about earlier about being outdoors and being, you know, kind of black outside.
Yes.
And, you know, and what, you know, what our history is as black folks and, you know, to, you know, in relation to the earth and, you know, and the earth, capital E, the earth, small e, you know, the erasure, the connections, the herbs, you know, all the things, right? So that's an amazing thing to read. I've been reading anthologies. Then there are three
okay.
that are, that have created a wonderful spectrum. One of them is Black Cool, which is edited by Rebecca Walker. One of them is Black Futures, edited by Kimberly Drew and Jay Wortham. And the other one is that old chestnut, The Black Book, which I know Toni Morrison had a hand in back in 1964. Huh. There was a 35th anniversary edition that was issued right before she died. And she wrote the foreword to that. And that just, it just shows, all these books just show how many different ways there are to be Black. Yes. And that's what I love. I love just that, you know, it's just like, you know, you don't have to adhere to this. You don't have to, you know, be able to dance like Beyonce. You know, none of that stuff has to happen. We're all legitimate folks here on the planet. So yeah. Let's celebrate that and check each other out.
Beautiful. Oh, there's so much to choose from there. That's really great. Thank you so much for that. And thank you for this conversation. It's been really, really wonderful.
I am just so pumped to have done this with you. It's great to just have your energy out here in the world like this. Thank you for having a podcast and for doing what you do, Michael.
Thanks again for listening to Incognito, the podcast, season 3. If you're a new listener, welcome. I hope you found something here that you can use in your work life or your community. And if you are returning, I'm really happy to continue to have your support. As always, we welcome your suggestions and encourage you to rate and comment in your podcast app. Ratings and comments help people find us and allows us to spread the word about this work. Also, you can find us on Instagram at IncognitoThePlay. Find us there, follow us, and hit us up with a question or comment. Look, we have limited social media presence, so I'm also urging you to take an additional step to tell someone you know about this work. I'll be back again next week with yet another conversation that delves deeply into identity, authenticity, and ways in which we can create inclusive communities and workspaces.